Good morning, everyone. I just want to set up a quick scenario for you, so just bear with me. And you might have seen this story in the news lately. It was how they always have these shark sightings off of the coast of Long Island, and they'll show a picture from a drone, and they'll have this gentleman on a paddleboard, kind of just paddling along on the ocean. And it's beautiful, it's nice, serene. Even the color is nice. You can see right through the water, which is weird that if it's Long Island, I don't know if that really is true. But underneath the surface, you can see a silhouette of a shark that's kind of lurking there, following him a little bit. And it was actually pretty cool because it was a silhouette of a hammerhead, which tends to be a little grumpier than your average shark. So it was a perilous situation. So I thought about that, and it kind of looked familiar. And I just want to read you what the dictionary's version of complacency is. Complacency in the Merriam-Webster dictionary is described as self-satisfaction, especially when accompanied by unawareness of actual dangers or deficiencies. So we have to be careful of complacency in everything in our lives, right? Whether it be at work, whether it be in our relationships, whether it be in if we go to school, but especially in our spiritual life. We can't get complacent when we get in our spiritual life. We constantly have to keep moving forward. We have to grow. We can't let something just kind of stay there and think that we are not in danger and that we have our own understanding and how we're going to handle things in our lives. We have to put everything that we have at the foot of our Lord. We have to pray for it. We have to connect ourselves with those that go before us. That's how we don't get complacent. And especially in our prayer life, that's one of the ways that we don't get complacent, but that we put all of our understanding in God's hands and that we don't interpret things and we say, well, you know, I don't understand this, or I do understand it, so I'm going to handle it myself. A lot of times we don't. That's it. So have a good morning and enjoy the rest of the summer. And be careful of those sharks.
In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Dear loving Heavenly Father, we bow before you this morning, glad that we can be in your house, glad that you have taught us to set aside this time, that today is the Sabbath. Today is the day we can reconnect with you and really focus. We try to, dear Heavenly Father, each day. We may start in the morning and pray to you. We may try to listen to gospel music. We may try to focus on you and think about your work, even while we're at work or at school or at home. But dear Heavenly Father, today we come together. Today we worship you. Today we praise you. We put you in the proper place in our hearts, or we try to. But dear Heavenly Father, you have also done so much for us. You have shared your word with us. You have taught us. You have sent your Son to die on the cross for us, that we can have the forgiveness of sins, and we can also have the communion with Christ, that he has broken and shed his body and blood for us, that we could have that strength. Dear Heavenly Father, our whole mind and being and spirit focuses on that. We want to have a relationship with you. We want to connect ourselves with you. We want to experience that moment with you, that we can experience that oneness, that communion with Christ, that he is our bridegroom, we are his bride. Dear Heavenly Father, we think of those who are connected, those who could not be here, those who are on vacation. Please touch them. Let them know that they are loved. Let them know that they are part of this congregation. We miss them. We are one with them. Dear Heavenly Father, please bless those who have cares and concerns they place on your altar. Dear Heavenly Father, we know so many issues and so many worries and so many plans for the future, but we want to connect with you. We want to know that you see the future. We want to remember to trust you. Dear Heavenly Father, please bless those things. Bless those feelings of trust and of assurance and of peace, even in spite of those difficulties, even in spite of those worries and plans for the future. Let that live within each and one of us. And we bow our hearts before you. We also want to connect ourselves with those who go before us in the apostles' ministry. Keep it strong for us, and let us have an hour in heaven. Please be with us now, and send your Son. We long to go home. Please make us worthy. This we ask and pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
So, my dear brothers and sisters, good morning. This morning we have a Bible verse out of Genesis, the third chapter, and just the ninth verse. Then the Lord God called to Adam and said to him, "Where are you?" So we have a response hymn. You may be seated. So, my dear brothers and sisters, it's good to be with you, even on this warm, sunny, beautiful day out, July. And I can't help but see the irony of holding a summer service with a small congregation with the title, "Where Are You?" Brothers and sisters, my family's not here. They're on vacation too. But dear brothers and sisters, it's The Lord wasn't asking Adam because he didn't know where he was. The Lord God Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, who had just made mankind, knew exactly where Adam was. Of course, I think we can all imagine he was doing it for Adam's benefit. Everything the Lord does, he's done for our benefit. So he asks Adam and says, "Where are you?" Making Adam take a moment and think. To take a moment and be retrospective and say, "Oh, where am I?" It's about the heart's attitude. Goes back, I've heard this, what's the most important thing in real estate? Location, location, location. What's the most important thing in our faith? Heart's attitude, heart's attitude, heart's attitude. And, well, we kind of know, yeah, this is important. And yet I think we always fall into these same traps. And in our article for this morning, the chief apostle points out that there's a bunch of ways we can fall. We could be like Adam and Eve and be shameful and say, "Okay, I did something wrong. Ah, man, I really don't belong. Don't look at me." And we can try to hide from the Lord. We could be doubtful. We could have a little bit of a shaky foundation. We could say, "Okay, what is this all about? Maybe this is wrong. I don't know if I believe anymore. I don't understand." And the chief apostle pointed to Psalms. And this is where one of the Psalms is just pouring out his heart. It's Psalm 42. If you want some homework, you can read Psalm 42. But one of the verses there is, "All around me they ask, where is your God?" He's being plagued by doubt. He's being plagued by people asking him, "Are you doing the right thing? Come into service on a Sunday when the weather looks like this outside?" We could be misled. We think of Saul, who is trying to follow, trying to do exactly what he thought was right, and persecuted all these Christians who are corrupting his faith, who what he was called to do. And suddenly the Lord touches him and says, "Why are you persecuting me?" We could be in all those situations, and yet, what do we learn? We learn, one, he seeks us out. Even when we are in these circumstances, even when we're shameful, doubtful, or misled, he seeks us out. He sought them out and said, "I'm here. Don't forget." And yet, he teaches us too. He comes along and says, "I'm here, and I'm going to show you the way. I'm going to show you the right thing to do if you just listen to me." She's also talked about being fearful or overwhelmed. When the disciples were in the boat, this is in Luke 8, the disciples are in the boat and the storms come and the Lord Jesus is sleeping and they're terrified and they shake him and wake him up and say, "The Lord, we're going to perish." And Jesus, the first thing he says is, "Where is your faith? What happened to you guys? I called you, I did all of these things. What's wrong with you?" And again, another great moment of, please, take a moment and be retrospective. Think about this. And he calms the waves and calms the storms, and suddenly everything was different. We could be maybe a little egotistical sometimes. We could be, well, maybe we're not fearful. Maybe we think, "I can handle this. I'm good. I'm trained, I'm an adult now." The Lord Jesus also speaks to this point. Once in Mark 9, he asked the disciples, "What were you talking about back there on the road? Well, I heard something, I didn't quite hear it all. What are you talking about?" And the disciples kind of sheepishly looked at each other and said, "We were talking about who's going to sit at your right hand. There's 12 of us. You've only got one seat. Which of us is going to be that guy? Which of us is going to be the greatest? Their ego started coming out, and they're like, oh, this is kind of cool. This is great. This guy is that we're following is the real deal. And the Lord Jesus put them also again in their place and said, the servant, your servant is the greatest of you. The least of you is the greatest. We say, okay. We spoke in the sacristy. I think sometimes we're a great big mix of all of these things. Throw it all in there. I got all of them. I'm fearful and shameful and misled and doubtful and egotistical with an extra dash in there. We say, all right. The Lord asks you, where are you? What are you like today? Are you with me? Are you here with me? Because I'm here. I want to be with you. Are you with me? How do we get from here to there? We had a small group a few months ago where I think I've said this before, but the Bible verse was, unless you hate your parents, you can't be part of me. And he said a few others, but that was the catch for us. It was like, how the Lord's telling us to hate our parents? And he talked about hating your brother and hating your siblings, and it was this really catch of like, how do I understand this? And the idea here is that the Lord was saying, I want my relationship with you, the love you have for me, to be so bright, to be so great, that it makes all your other relationships look like hate. I want our relationship to be like the sun that blocks out even the other things like a candle. The candle's good. The candle provides light and warmth and all this good stuff, but compared to the sun. So we sat in the small group saying, wow, that's awesome. That would be beautiful. A life like that, where my relationship with my God is like a light to my path. It's like the sun, it's warmth, it's light, it's energy, it's everything I need. And we all sat in the small group and said, how do we get from here to there? Because I'm not there right now. And I think we can all take this moment. The Lord says, where are you? And we all can take that retrospective moment and say, I'm all of these things. I'm a mixed up, mumbled up souffle of all this stuff. And I don't know how to get from here, where I am, to where I need to be. Lord, tell me, what do I have to do? How do I get from being doubtful to having faith? How do I get from being fearful and overwhelmed to having peace? One of the other things we talked about in small group once was this idea that faith, you believe something. We believe in Jesus. And this small idea, this small little thing of I believe in Jesus, becomes this entire thing for us, where one, you believe that Jesus is part of the triune God. You believe that he's come to earth and died for you. If that's true, then he must be in our hearts a savior. He must be our Messiah. He must be Lord and King above all things. And if that's true, then that only demands the best and greatest devotion. And we might say, wow, I can see that state of me being completely and utterly devoted to him, that all I do is focused on him. I sacrifice my being, my life, my will for him because I know that he died for me and that he is God. And he is my Lord. He is my King. I listen to everything he says. And again, we see a gap. How do I get from here to there? I want a relationship with him that's like the sun. I want to be devoted to him and make my life focused on him. But right now it's not. I kind of know that that's where I want to be. I've made that decision. I have that mustard seed. I have that little bit. I know where I want to be because the Lord has sought me out, has tapped me on the shoulder, has looked at me and talked to me and said, "Where are you?" He's sought me out. He's talked to me. And here now, I'm this bundle of emotion. I'm this bundle of nervousness and worry and uncertainty. But I know that there's this place I can be, this point at which I can get to, that I've devoted my life to him, and that he's shown me who he is in all of these different aspects of life. How do I get there? I don't know. I think it's a journey. I think it's a continuous activity. This is why we come. This is why we have the Holy Communion, to give us strength to get from here to there. But it takes work for us too. It takes activating that strength. It takes harnessing it and actually doing something. So what are those things? They're little habits, little things. Reading the Bible. Oh, I've heard that for a long time. I've heard that since I was a kid. I have not read it. I've read a whole bunch of books. I have not completely read the Bible. And I thought about that. I said, I want to go from here to there. I know I do. And yet, I haven't read the whole thing. It's a pretty big book. Lots of pages. But I thought about this. For those of us who have a significant other, husband, wife, boyfriend, girlfriend, imagine for a moment they're away from you. They're going to prepare, I don't know, a house. They're preparing a party. They're preparing a vacation together. And you get a voicemail on your cell phone. Do you listen to it? A voicemail on your cell phone from the love of your life. And you say, "Yeah, I'll listen to it later." Kind of sounds terrible, right? There's something wrong with this relationship, you realize, right? Like, I have voicemails from a whole bunch of clients. I have voicemails from a whole bunch of people I work with. Yeah, I'll get to it. It's the weekend. I'll talk to them on Monday. But our Heavenly Father has spoken to us. He's given us scripture. He's given us these stories of these people who have been in situations like us. Paul, who's completely backwards, and the Lord touches him and says, "Turn around, you're going the wrong way, go this way." David, who's constantly being super strong and then completely falling apart the next moment. It's in here. These moments of these people who have followed, who have tried to follow, who have struggled like us. And there's these stories that we could learn from. Read the Bible. Pray to him. Prayer, another good one we've heard our whole life of faith. But a prayer that is a communication, a speaking. I have heard it's a good thing when my wife talks to me, she has a problem. I've been told, don't fix the problem. That's not the idea. She's talking to you not for you to say, "Well, you should have done, you know what you should have done." That's not helpful. I mean, that's kind of what I've been wired to do, but unfortunately, I'm learning. But fortunately, I'm learning. Sometimes we just need to talk it out. Sometimes we just need to breathe, to think, to take a moment and say, "What is going on?" Or maybe you don't like to be in your head all the time. Maybe it's not so easy to wade through those waters. Instead, you need to talk to someone. Brothers and sisters, that's why we call each other brothers and sisters. We should be able to talk to each other. We should focus on creating relationships in our congregation so that we can talk to each other and have a habit of sharing and have a habit of talking, because when one's up, the other might be down. This is a habit that will bring us from where we are to where we want to be. If we read the Bible a little bit, we pray just a little bit more, talk to him and try to work through stuff, talk to each other. And the chief apostle underlines and makes sure we know he will be there. Just look for him. Look to him. A couple weeks ago, Priest Gauthier talked about just breathe. Just take that moment of retrospective. For some of you, it might be to close in the doors, get into your small, quiet space, and open the scriptures. Some of you might be, I need to pick up the phone, and I need to call my friend, because I need to talk this out. Some of you might be, I need to fold my hands, and just, I need to be in my car, and just, I need to pray. I don't know what else to do. Some of us, it might be just to sit and look at the creation. Look at all that God's done for us. Look at our diary of all the things the Lord has done. Dear brothers and sisters, these are little habits. These are little things we can add into our lives. We can say, I can do this a little bit better because I know where I want to go. I know where I want to be. I want to have a relationship that makes everything else in my life pale in comparison. I want to have a devotion to him that makes me truly understand my purpose in life, truly understand exactly why I'm here. Because then I feel accomplishment. Then I feel fulfillment. Then I feel like I know why what I'm doing. But right now, I'm all over the place. I don't know what I'm doing. And the Lord says, where are you? I'm here for you. I want you to do these things. So we have to take those moments, dear brothers and sisters, to try it. Try it out. Maybe you haven't done one of those things before. Maybe your focus has been in other areas. Maybe to read the Bible. There's a lot of great apps out there. Bible 365, if you haven't tried it. A bit of the Bible every day. Prayer. There's a lot of great ideas on what makes a great prayer life. I'll give you a tip. Try a tip. Adoration, thanks, intercession, and petition. Try to put your prayer in that order. Talk to each other. Join a small group. And get outside and look at all he's done for us. All that he continues to do for us. Dear brothers and sisters, just here on Sunday in the Lord's house, we can know and be reminded the Lord has done everything already for your soul's salvation. There's nothing else he needs to do. He's done it. We can be thankful for that. Dear brothers and sisters, we've got a long way to go. Just like Adam, he asks us, where are you? Not because he doesn't know, not because he's confused by us, but because he wants us to take a moment to try these things, to try to deepen our relationship with him, because he sees what it could be like. He sees, I used to walk and talk with Adam and Eve in paradise. I want to get back to there. So I sent my son. They really need to use that, don't they? They really need to step it up. I've given them all of these things, all of these examples, all of these things in history. Let me prick their hearts. Let me touch them so that they use it, so that they try a little bit more and have a better relationship with me. Amen. So we can have the acceptance hymn, then we can prepare for Holy Communion. So, my dear brothers and sisters, as we prepare for Holy Communion, the first thing we do is we pray the Lord's Prayer. And this is the prayer the Lord taught when he wanted to show them how the disciples were supposed to pray. And I thought about this, even in reference to preparing for this morning. We should pray more. We should pray. I said a tip, adoration, thanks, intercession, petition. It's a good way to form your prayer, to pray first about adoring him, worshiping him, putting him in the right place. Because of that, we then thank him and say, oh, well, I realize now, as I'm thinking about this, that you are great. You are all of these things, and you've done all of these things. I guess I should say thank you. So let me say thank you. Thank you for all these things. Thank you for my friends, my family, my loved ones. Ah, and that suddenly turns into, yeah, but that one's going through something tough. Let me pray for them. And we intercede for others. And then we finally get to petition. And the Lord's Prayer is another really, really good mirror for us to look at our prayers. In these moments in preparation, we put everything in there. We breathe with this. We say together, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's a lot of adoration. That's a lot of glorifying him. That is a lot of petitioning in intercession for each other. I want your kingdom to rule here. I want everything to be according to your will. That's a really great one. We had this discussion with some of the children in a children's service recently. We talked about our prayer life and how there's this one piece that ATIP doesn't really cover. This last piece of, but not my will, but your will be done. That kind of turns it all around. And you see that immediately in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, holy is your name. Your kingdom come and your will be done. Sometimes we put that at the end of our prayer. We say, this is all the things I want, but not my will, but your will be done. Amen. The Lord's Prayer puts it first. Something to learn from. Something to put our heart into. Can we prioritize that way? Give us this day our daily bread. I thought that was interesting. It's a communal us. It is a plural. It is intercession and petition all mixed up into one. But only one line. Give us today what we need today. And together. We'll have to make it work together. We'll have to make it work between us. Sometimes, I think most of the time, my prayer is, give me today what I need for this week. We say, well, that's not what the Lord's taught us. And do not lead us into temptation, or forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. And that's where the sticking point is. That's what this preparation for Holy Communion is all about. The Lord says, I've given you my strength. I've given you the ability to carry on. In that children's service, we talked about the last phrase of our prayers. We tend to say, in Jesus' name. And the kids could not answer what that means. Why do we say that? In Jesus' name. And we talked about how prayer, we talked about a billionaire. If a billionaire was your friend and you asked them for something and he said, just say my name and they'll take care of it. You want to fly to Hawaii? Go. Talk to this travel agent and say my name. We'll take care of it. And suddenly the kids were like, ooh, toys, this, that, and the other thing. We said, okay, let's keep going. Let's keep going. Okay, you've gotten this, you've gotten that, you've gotten the, okay. Suddenly $1 billion goes by pretty quick in the thoughts of a child, right? And suddenly your friend calls and says, hey, what have you been doing? And you said, well, I've been using your name all over the place. You didn't tell me that was okay, but I did it anyway. Dear brothers and sisters, do we do that? Do we pray for things without thinking, is this what Jesus would want? Is this what Jesus has taught me? We pray to him because we pray with that phrase because we say, I pray these things because Jesus said he would do for me what I need. I pray in Jesus' name that you could help me, Father. I pray because I want this relationship, because he's my bridegroom. You are my Father. And we pray these things, but do we think about it? Suddenly we have to put that at the beginning of the prayer, put that at the beginning, put that uppermost in our thoughts when we pray. You are holy, and I pray in perfect unity, in perfect oneness with my bridegroom, Jesus. Suddenly, the things we pray for get jumbled up in our minds, and we say, oh, maybe that's not what's most important. The Lord's Prayer helps us there and is perfect in this preparation for, I want to use the strength to do better. And we put our hearts into it, and we say, Let me put the things in the right order. Holy is your name. Let your kingdom come in all things. Help us all today have what we need, but just for today. Let us have this relationship with each other that is perfect, that is forgiveness between us, because they are also your bride. We are together, brothers and sisters. And then it ends. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory. Again, looking ahead, looking forward, looking to that place we want to be. For yours is the kingdom. If you were truly king in my life, then this would look a whole lot different. All this, there would be glory in everything and would last forever. And then we stop and we come forward for Holy Communion. And we need it. We see the gap. We see the division. We see the span of how far we need to go. And we say, I can't possibly do it. We can try to do it together. Together as a congregation, we need to be together to have a chance. But we need him to help us. And he's done it. He sacrificed his life so we can have this moment of strength, this moment of being with him, of having his body and blood for us. So let us put that into the Lord's Prayer. Let us put that in our hearts when we come forward, and let us use it in the coming days. Amen. So let us rise and pray the Lord's Prayer together. And we pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. In the commission of my sender, the apostle, I proclaim unto you the glad tidings. In the name of the Lord Jesus, the Son of the living God, your sins are forgiven. The peace of the risen one abide with you. Amen. Dear loving Father, we can say thanks for the forgiveness, thanks that you sent your Son, that he has died on the cross for us, that he has traded places, that we realize that from Adam and Eve until now, there has been a gap, there has been a division that each and every one of us experiences, but because of your Son, because of this ever-valid sacrifice, you have bridged the gap. Dear Heavenly Father, we give thanks that you have established this plan of salvation for us, that you could make the change that is necessary. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to... Dear Heavenly Father, we want to use it. We want to use the strength in Holy Communion. We want to feel the peace and assurity of your love and your forgiveness. We want to be changed and be the kind of children of God you want us to be. Dear Heavenly Father, let that live within us, let it sink into our hearts, and let us be changed. Please be with us now, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
And now we shall celebrate Holy Communion. Now the Lord's table is prepared. In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I consecrate bread and wine for Holy Communion, and lay thereupon the once brought, eternally valid sacrifice of Jesus Christ. For the Lord took bread and wine, gave thanks, and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. This is my blood of the new covenant, given for many for the remission of sins. Eat and drink. Do this in remembrance of me." For as often as you eat this bread and drink this wine, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Amen.
Amen.
Body and blood of Jesus given for you. Amen. Congregation, you may be seated. Congregation is invited to Holy Communion, and we can listen to the instrumental. Let us rise and close with a prayer. Loving Heavenly Father, once more, what can we say but thank you? Humbled we are to experience your word and experience the forgiveness of sins and experience the Holy Communion. Once more, we have this opportunity to go out and be changed, that we can try a little bit more to walk on the steps of faith, to grow this mustard seed we have, to have it blossom, have it change our lives completely, that we can truly exemplify these words of your kingdom come in our lives. For our relationship with you to be like the sun compared to everything else. And for us to be able to get to this point of complete devotion, that you are the King, Lord, Savior, Messiah of our whole entire lives. Dear Heavenly Father, we are humbled by that. And yet we also have purpose now, have focus, have determination to go forward. And yet there are also crosses. Dear Heavenly Father, let them take the right order in our lives. Let our love for you and our connection with you make everything else a little bit easier, a little bit better, a little bit more understandable, that we can truly feel your love, your guidance, your presence, that we can be touched each day and get this question asked of us, where are you? Not out of accusation, but out of a desire for you to connect with us. Heavenly Father, let us respond to you each day. Let us respond to you in our hearts. Let us be able to uplift each other and keep each other focused on this path. And let us be able to be changed, that we can truly be children of God. We can truly be your bride, that we can truly be ready for when your son returns. Please make us worthy. This we ask and pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. So it was nice to be together. We have a hymn together. Why don't we sing while we're standing? Now thank we all our God. So you may be seated. Any announcements? Please remember those who are on vacation or away. Next Sunday, the Apostle Schnabel will be here for some celebration. So looking forward to that together with the congregation. Thank you. Have a great week.
Am I on? Good morning, good afternoon, whatever it is. This is going to be a 1 or 2 minute announcement. A few months ago, us fellas that were in the prayer group, we talked about it and we said, actually, Charlie said, gee, we don't have enough fun. So Charlie, this is for you, okay? We've tried to come up with some thoughts and ideas on how we can have a little fun. And then it evolved and it evolved and it evolved, and we have an idea. And the idea is our first ever Sunset Fellowship cruise. With the help of Steve, the fellow who knows about boats, we've contracted with the Super Hawk. That's a 75-foot boat that goes out of Point Lookout, Steve. And we want to see if we can fill that boat up. It's going to be a 6:30 to 9 p.m. sunset cruise. Now, if that doesn't sound romantic, I don't know what is. On top of it being for fun, for me personally, there's some people in this congregation that I don't know a whole lot about, and I really would like to. I know this guy Heller. I know he's got a big couple of big guys that play football, but I don't know him that well. Hope you don't mind me using you, but too bad, I already did. This girl over here, her name is Lauren. I have a Lauren, so I've got to find out what Lauren is all about. The family in the back there, I know they're from Haiti, but I don't really know them. I'd like to get to know them. I don't know if you feel that way about anybody else. Coming to church is very nice, but wouldn't it be nice to have something a little bit outside of church where we can be together? I don't know this guy. Oh, wait a second. Oh, yeah, that's, yeah, I know him. He came to Ridgewood 46 years ago as a deacon. I said, who's this guy? But now I finally figured it out. To make a long story short, you're welcome to come. It's going to cost you $25, which is that much to rent the boat. Steve is working out the rest. He's playing the slot machines, hoping that he gets enough money from Wins to pay for the rest of the boat. But we can only fit 70 people on the boat, and if we don't get them from here, we're going to get them from other congregations. So if you want to have a little fun, there's going to be snacks, there's going to be sandwiches. The evangelist Kimitek is working out the details on that, and we'll have more information. I made a real crummy flyer, so I'm going to give this to Janice, who's going to make it look really nice and probably erase half of the things that I have here. But who's invited? Where are you? Okay, I'm sorry. Oh, shh. August 20th, it's a Saturday. August 20th, 6:30 to 9 p.m. If you have a fishing pole and you want to bring it, we may stop long enough to make a turn. We're not going in deep waters, so if right away you think I'm not getting on a boat, we're going through the reeds in and out of Point Lookout. I don't know if anybody was invited to Steve's wedding, I don't know how many years ago, but that was so nice. You didn't even know you were moving. It was real class. That's what we're hoping to do. Everybody's invited. Sunday school, where is preschool? There he is, preschool. Please push it with the Sunday school. We don't have the youth. Push it with the youth. Push it with your family, even if you don't like them. Bring them along. I have a bunch of people that I can invite, you know. If they come, that would be nice, I guess. You would have a good time with them. Maybe my brother will be here in time for that. Yes. There'll be probably about a half hour worth of fishing, okay? I'm sorry? Steve, say it again. Okay, so we just added a half hour till 9:30. Sunset cruise. Think about it. If you want to come, please either see me or Steve. Steve is handling 90% of what's going on. He asked me to be the mouthpiece because he knows, well, he knows. Okay? Oh, by the way, Santi, you're going, okay? You don't have to tell me. And you can either bring your wife and kids or just come alone. That's the way it's going to be. If you have a friend, if you have someone who maybe hasn't been in church in a while, this is not going to be a churchy thing, okay? I plan on bringing wine and cheese, drinking the whole bottle and eating the whole wedge of cheese. You do what you want. There'll be some snacks and sandwiches. But let's have a little fun. COVID is kind of like fading away. We haven't been together for something nice for a long time. Please, if you want to come, let us know. You don't have to have your $25 now, but within the next couple of weeks, we're going to be looking for it because the boat costs a lot of money, okay? And by the way, you're already coming. If you didn't know it, I just volunteered you, okay? And as I go around, this guy in the back here that works the audio visual, I don't know him. So I said, he's coming. And the other guy in the window over there, he's coming too. We don't know these guys. They do a wonderful job, but who are they? I don't know. Let's find out who's who, okay? Let's talk. Let's be friends. Let's be warm with each other. It's not always this way, okay? It's not always like that. Lose that for 3.5 hours, okay? That's my spiel. Please, if you would like to come, talk to Steve or talk to me. Thank you. Have a nice day.